Good morning, everybody. See, if you look at GIS as a field, Geographic Information System, it's a subject by itself. It's a full-fledged subject which can be run as a one-semester program or one-degree program and all. It's very difficult to give justification to the subject within 90 minutes, but I'll try my best to give at least an overview. And, you know, from the questions which I saw from yesterday's portions, there had been a question even use of remote sensing and GIS for watershed modeling. So maybe, you know, many of you may be familiar with GIS, but for the benefit of other participants, I'll try to give you an overview in as simple as possible. But, you know, one cannot cover a lecture on an overview avoiding theory, but I'll try to make it as simple as possible. And of course, following this lecture, afternoon, you will have a demonstration of the GIS package itself. And following the demonstration, we will show you some of the applications which have been done using the GIS tool, which we will be demonstrating in the afternoon. Okay. See, just before going to the theory, the one thing I want to tell. See, now I come from a residence to this department to deliver the lecture. Naturally, when I leave my residence, I'll try to see which is the optimal route through which I should come so that I can come on time for starting the lecture. This is my case. Now you take another case. Like an agriculture person, a farmer is there. He would like to cultivate crop during Kharif or Rabi season or summer season. He will try to see what crop he should cultivate in that season so that his profit is reasonable. That will depend on what is rainfall, terrain condition, land use practices, etc., etc. Now, suppose a person is there on an irrigation department. He will try to see when he has to let out water from the reservoir, based on for what land utility is being done, what is that, whether there had been a rainfall, everything seeing that, he will try to decide it. See, there are number of questions which we come across every day for solving many problems. If you look at all these questions, what will you see? You will see that all these questions refer to some geographical processes on the surface of the earth. There are number of questions which we come across, which we try to solve, and everything refers to some geographical surfaces on the ground, some spatial phenomena on the ground. Okay? So, question is easy. We have to solve it. So, how do we do? Even a simple question, as I said, I need the optimal path to reach this place. I don't need a shortest path. I need an optimal path. So, naturally, I'll try to see what is the road network, how many traffic signals are there, which route I should take, maybe a longer route, but signals may be less. I may have a flyover through which I can come. So, you know, even to solve any simple question which is of spatial in nature, you have to collect data from different sources, integrate them, and then analyze them. Isn't it? Because it's a daily problem which we try to see. So, to do this, to solve these kinds of problems which are spatial based, the technology of GIS comes into picture. GIS, if you really want to define, it can be considered art, science, engineering, or technology. Because I won't consider GIS as completely a geography field. I won't consider it's a maths field. Because see, I am from mathematics field. I cannot consider that it belongs to pure science. Or I cannot say, okay, it's only an engineering. It has the technology also which gets involved. So the art or science or engineering or discipline which tries to solve you these kinds of problems is the GIS technology. Okay? So now, you know, this particular GIS discipline started generating massive interest worldwide. In fact, if you look at it today, there is no field where GIS cannot be applied. That is the way this technology is growing. It's not only civil engineering or environmental people or geology people. Any planning, any management, everybody wants to use this field. And you know, especially along with the technology of remote sensing, this GIS started growing. Because you know, the benefits which came from handling remote sensing data, computer science field, everything got incorporated into this interdisciplinary area. Okay, so during over the last, in fact, you know, I started working during 80s. And today, every day, this technology is growing. Okay, during last 3 decades, there has been a very rapid rate of improvement, development, etc. The theory side, technology side, application side, organizational side, implementation side, etc., etc. Okay, and as I said, it doesn't belong to one discipline or technology or art or science. It is 100% an interdisciplinary area. In fact, if you come to my department, I'll tell I am from completely a mathematics background person from this institute. My team consists of people from computer science, electrical engineering, physics, geography. Like, you know, it's a heterogeneous group which works. So GIS is an interdisciplinary area which covers people from computer science, mathematics, civil engineering, economics, agriculture, etc., etc. Okay? And overall, if you try to look at GIS technology, broadly we can categorize into 3 parts. One is hardware and software, because, you know, it is not that GIS is new. Conventionally, people would have also used centuries back. Those days also people have taken massive decisions. But, you know, they would have used manual approach. Today, we are all in the digital technology. Okay? So, naturally, when you think of digital field, hardware is needed and the tool is needed, which is the software. So, when you try to broadly categorize GIS, one is hardware and software. Next is what for that software is. Naturally, you are going to pull the data, put it and process it. So, information processing. And what for you are processing the information, naturally to apply for something. So, when you categorize GIS, you can broadly put it as hardware and software, information processing, and then applications. Okay? We said information processing, the title itself says geographic information system. So, we should know what is an information. So, what is an information? Think. See, I give you a number. I say, okay, I am working in IIT. I say my number is 2572 something. 1237, I tell. If I just give a number, 2572 1237, does it mean anything? It is just a value, a number. Moment I say it is the telephone number of so and so, the same data becomes what? Now an information. So information is derived from the interpretation of data, which are symbolic representations of the features. But you know, whenever we say information, we have to see the value of the information. See, suppose I work in an area where I get data 3 decades back. Today, every day, you know, suppose you go to an urban area, every day the city is growing. Every day there is a change. Okay, suppose somebody gives me 3 decades old data. He may even give me freely the data. Will it be useful to me? Unless you are working the temporal changes. What was there, what is today? Other than that, you know, you want to do some planning as of today, you need the data as of today. So the value of information will depend on its timeliness, the context in which it is applied. Say, suppose I am working on water resources application. Somebody gives me, you know, a lot of demographic data. Probably a few parameters I may use, may not be other information. So the value also will depend on the context in which it's applied. And, you know, I may have data, I may have information, etc. If I put it in my cupboard in a file, can I access it whenever I need it? So what happens? It depends on the storage, manipulation and presentation. It should be easily accessible. It should be easily processable. It should be represented the way the user needs. Okay? So information is an asset. It is power today. It can be bought and sold for prices. That is the way today information is there. But this information, when you try to represent in the form in such a way, users can analyze it, manipulate it, process it and represent it, there comes the information system. Okay, from data we came information, from information then naturally information system comes into picture. Then when you say information system, if you see the theory, broadly we can divide into 2 major categories. One is called as transaction processing system, other is called decision support system. What is transaction processing system? You go to banks. Today, you know, everything is computerized, whether you go to bank or whether you go to railways, either you go for airline booking, everything, you know, you just give, he will see, and you know, if your PNR moves up, he says, okay, you have moved up, your reservation is confirmed. Everything is online. You go to bank, you put money, it gets credited, you take money, it gets debited. Everything is what happens. There the occurrence occurs as per the way it is happening. There is a clear cut rule in updation and the method they have to follow. So, you know, there it works in such a way, updation can be done in a clear cut procedure. Whenever you go to the place like airlines or railways or banks. So those kind of processing or the information system, we call it as transaction processing system. So it is very easy. There is no, you know, extra modeling or thinking or anything. Well defined rules are followed. The other thing is a decision support system. Here what we try to do, here emphasis is on analysis, modeling, manipulation, etc. so that the data can be used finally to an end user. So here what happens, the same information system becomes a decision support system. So geographic information system is a DSS. The heart of GIS is its manipulation and analysis. Okay, the more powerful it is in analysis, the usefulness increases. Okay, geographic information system is an information system in the category of a DSS. In fact, you know, GIS, we call it as a spatial decision support system. So a geographic information system is a tool which can accept large volumes of spatial data. That's a place where it differs from other types of databases and information systems. Large volumes of spatial data derived from variety of sources, retrieve, manipulate, analyze, etc., and display them according to user-defined specification. Why people are working more and more on GIS? As I said, see, suppose there is one integrated GIS for an area, like let me take our own city, Mumbai city. All data, let us say our municipal corporation of Greater Mumbai, they have all data, let us assume. It will not be useful only for them. Everybody can use the same data for his application as far as utility is concerned, decision is concerned, planning is concerned. So, you know, once you form a GIS for an application, it can help several users and it can display the result according to his application. That's why, and display them according to user-defined specifications. And of course, whenever we talk about GIS, one has to keep in picture that GIS has got both spatial data as well as attribute data. We call non-spatial data, we call as spatial data, attribute data and all. See, suppose I have the village boundaries. Let us take our ward boundary of Mumbai. If I just put a map nicely with the ward boundary, will it be alone useful? It will be a showpiece. Moment I have to attach it, how many people are living in the ward? How many facilities are there? It may be in terms of school, it may be in terms of hospitals, it may be in terms of banks. How many school going children are there? All data have to be added to that boundary so that a planner can use it. So GIS has both spatial data and supported attribute data. And why this, you know, GIS is, it's, of course it's very useful. But you know, if you really look at deeper, why it becomes very, very useful? The thing is, you cannot see any event occurring across the world without a spatial reference. You take a newspaper in the morning, New Delhi, comma, Mumbai, comma, Patna, comma, like that they write the news. See, any event occurs, it is spatial in nature. Nothing happens without giving, even this class is happening in this room. We say moment CEP course means comma, comma, in this room. In this building, IIT Bombay, we write it. So if you really see, everything is spatial in nature and GIS is a technology which handles this spatial data. So that is why its usefulness and power increases every day. And if you really look at its applications, GIS can be applied in every walk of life. Whether you are working for transportation engineering or for a canal alignment problem or locating a place where you can put a minor irrigation dam. In each case, on each every type of application, this technology can be used. Okay? But whenever we say spatial data, very easy to tell spatial data, but the problems follow. Because spatial data is not as easy to handle as you handle the other gated. It is always special in nature. The reason is the data is multidimensional. How it is multidimensional? We have X, we have Y. I have to refer a position. Wherever I need, I have to refer the height, terrain, tree. And then I have to refer the time. If I have to store meteorological data, naturally last year rainfall, this year rainfall, or last month rainfall, this month rainfall. So it is basically multidimensional nature. It has to cover X, Y, Z and time. Based on, of course, the application, okay? And the data is voluminous, voluminous. That to today's technology, if you take, you are all seeing, you know, we all see this Google Earth, we see the map, we see the images. Today, in what resolution we are working? In fact, the image data which they are putting is, all of us know, 0.6 meter resolution, and they have launched a new satellite with 0.5 meter resolution. So, you know, spatial data, when you say, it is voluminous in nature. It's not like those days you take a 50,000 scale topo sheet or a map, work everything and finalize. When you are in the digital platform, see those days we were happy with the 10 MB drive. Today even 160 GB drive we are not happy. That is the level, you know, storage capacity is increasing, the amount of data handling is increasing, the amount of data flowing is also increasing. Okay, spatial data nature is multidimensional, voluminous, and whenever we talk about the map data, surface data, earth data, etc., another major problem is that we are not on a flat ground. We are on an ellipsoidal surface. So the projection comes into picture. See, if I work only within the IIT campus, I can treat it as a flat terrain. I don't need any projection. But suppose I work for the whole state, the area of coverage is more. Naturally, the data has to be projected on a flat paper to work on a digital. I cannot scan a globe inside the computer. I have to only put a map and scan it. Okay? So projection comes into picture. The way of analysis, methods, modeling, everything changes. Because, you know, a person, because I saw the course title as soft computing. See, a person who is working on hydrology may integrate some model. Person who is working on agriculture may enter another model. So, you know, it needs unique analysis that has to be handled. And you know, as I said, even in the beginning, your GIS means you have to integrate data from different sources. See, when I work on an application, you go to different agency, collect data. All data may not be readily in the form you need it. All may not be in the same projection you need it. All may not be in the same scale you need it. And some may be in tabular form, some may be in map form, some may be in image form. So, you know, you need to integrate data from multi resources, and also data updation is very expensive. As I said, you know, information is, the timeliness is very essential. So one has to go and update the data, which is a time-consuming process. And whenever you want in the digital field, you say, okay, I get a query, I put a query, system should give me the answer immediately. Okay, so the thing is, if you look at really the spatial data, it is special in nature. There are some GIS books which talk one full chapter only the characteristics of spatial data. Why, you know, so difficult to handle, and what are the speciality in the this spatial data? Okay, so when this tool handles, overall GIS is a software tool. Don't assume, you know, it gives along with the database. You buy the software tool, you have to add the database, which will be the back end of the GIS, is it? So you buy a software tool, a GIS tool, you add your databases or data sets which you contain, and look at, when you look at spatial data, you have to look at GIS as a, of course, you know, this room is not a cuboid, it's of its own shape. You consider as a cuboid, like we have our rooms, one over the other you put the layers. So GIS has to be looked as a cuboid with the layers of maps. What I am telling is, you have to look at as a container with a layer of maps. The reason is, whenever you do an analysis in GIS, even though you pull the data from different sources, what you have to keep in mind is, all data must sit one over the other. You have to do pre-processing in the data in such a way. If you are covering for the city of Mumbai, or maybe let me say for the campus of IIT. Every map should sit one over the other. So when you are really doing processing in GIS, all must be of the same projection and same resolution. I cannot handle 25,000 scale data with the 10,000 scale data. You have to do a pre-processing in a GIS in such a way, finally during analysis, the data layers sit one over the other. Okay? So it is a container of maps, and the beauty is, whenever you try to analyze it using the data, using the proper methods, then it becomes a SDSS. It becomes a spatial decision support system. So GIS is the network of hardware, software, data, we people, and the procedures. Okay? And it started during, as I said, around last 3 decades, there is a rapid growth. See, if you look at GIS, the first best application, if you look at the history of GIS book, the one is the application which was done by the Canadian government, CGIS. That was the first thing which they said, Canadian Geographic Information System. They wanted to use computer for just mapping the land inventory. Those days we had mainframe systems like IBM systems. They made an attempt to take the data. See, remote sensing was parallelly growing. 1972 was the reason that first unmanned civilian satellite was launched. But during 60s, computers started coming. So that, you know, they thought, why not we use the digital world to store the map data and try to use it, at least keeping for an inventory. That is the way it started. And, you know, then started growing. In 72, Landsat satellite, the first civilian use satellite was launched by US government. And, you know, that if you look at, you see, there's a beautiful book on history of GIS, where how it grew every year they are put. Okay? So the thing is, there was a laboratory in Harvard, laboratory for computer graphics, where many, many people who passed out from that lab, they opened the GIS software companies, including the person who is the president of ESRA. He also passed out from that and he opened that company. So that is the way it started, that became as a start from which it started growing. Naturally, during 80s, ArcInfo came, Intergraph came, many GIS packages started coming. We all used the book, Professor P.A. Burrow's book of GIS. That was the first book which came as a book. Now today, you know, daily books are coming. Hundreds and hundreds of books are there, software is there, tools are available, users are millions. That is the way it has grown. And especially if you look at, you know, after 2000, we are all captured by www. We know nothing without web. So GIS also has molded itself for it. See, it has been quick enough to adopt this technology of web-based. Because when he showed the question of yesterday, first 2 questions were on web, I saw. Today, you know, nothing is there without web. Okay? So even in GIS, it's not only the desktop solution. People try to put the whole GIS tool so that sitting anywhere in a browser, you can do the query, you can do the analysis. Data may lie somewhere, analysis tool may lie somewhere, you may be sitting somewhere in any part of the world. You can analyze it. So even, you know, GIS has been quick enough to adopt this web-based technology. The advantage is, see, to implement a web-based server is expensive, difficult, put the data. But for users, it became easy to use and cheaper. See, whenever you try to use, you know, there are some websites in India which stores data even on a web-based GIS. Example is Census Department, NIC. You go, there are, you can take the data, query it and get the result. They would have spent a lot of money to build it. As a user, you don't need to spend any money. You query it and get the answer. So, you know, that moment that web-based GIS started coming and people started using internet technology, the number of users had grown into millions and millions, and every day it's growing. Okay. Now we saw that, you know, it's a spatial information system, handles spatial data. Now let us see what is this space. Because it is handling the spatial data, let us see the definition of space. Space is defined as a relation on a set of objects. Just see, the fundamental definition is, space is defined as a relation on a set of objects. I am here, you are there. I am an object, you are an object. I say I am in front of you. So we define our positions in relations with our positions. isn't it? So the general definition is, it is defined as a relation on a set of objects. Okay. So spatial objects are entities. How do they define them? If I say so and so, immediately I will not only put his position, I will say his name, maybe his qualification, etc., etc. He is a participant of this course. That will come into picture. So the spatial objects or entities are defined as a set of locations together with a set of attributes or properties characterizing these locations. So what we know, what is spatial objects. Okay. Then I said the relations. One thing whenever you work in GIS, one has to keep in mind is, say normally in geometry, what we say? We work on Euclidean geometry. So we say the distance between you and me, I can calculate. If we are three people, we can calculate the distance among our three of us. There is no problem. It's well defined. And in a triangle, what we say, sum of the two sides is always greater than the third side. These are all well defined geometry. So they are all what? Metric distances which we follow. But in GIS, when you come, it need not always hold this metric distances theory. That you have to keep in mind. It is not that, you know, it doesn't follow geometry. It follows fully geometry. But based on the applications, like I say, I put, you know, I'm in the road network. I have to reach this part. Instead of reaching this part, I may go that way and come here. The reason may be what? There may be many traffic jams which I have to avoid. So instead of going this way, I may go to the other place and then go. So, you know, one has to keep in mind, whenever based on the application you are working on GIS, non-metric spaces may arise when distances are need not be symmetric. So when I have to go to A to B, maybe when I'm coming B to A, I can come this way. There may not be any hindrance. But when I go to A to B, I'm taking a round route. So A to B need not be equivalent to B to A based on the application. So one has to keep in mind when they are handling as far as the spatial distances are concerned. Okay. So when we say the space and we want to put all the spatial objects into the GIS or into the spatial database in a GIS tool. So what type of objects we come across? We come across objects which are real in nature, like this building. The building has a structure. I can take a GPS, move around this building and get the boundary of this building exactly even in terms of lat long. Okay, so I have buildings, lakes, water bodies which are really existing, true objects. And there may be objects which may not exist, which you assume and do it. Have you anybody seen the contours existing anywhere? We all study on elevation. See, all of you are from water resources, you would have used topo sheets. You see the contours. We all assume the contours give us the elevation. Anybody has built around a wall, around any of the contour? No. They are all what? Fictitious lines assumed to be. They take the positions at some of the heights, interpolate it and draw the contours. Have you seen latitude, longitude, line or equator? No. These are all we assume they are there for some reference. So whenever we put the spatial objects, we cover what types of objects? Digital version of real objects. Then digital version of artificial features. And over and above, when you handle remote sensing data, what do you do? They try, satellite tries to take the images and they do the quantization and give the reflectance value for every pixel. So they are also artificial in nature. So in this, when you put, create a spatial database, we try to cover all these kinds of objects and try to store. So you know, all objects need not be real. There may be objects which are, do not exist, which are assumed village boundary. Again, you know, they are all approximated boundary done by an administrator, which we digitize and store it. Okay. So all these objects we try to store. So what are the components of spatial data? You can just look at it. One is, I said, I say he is sitting there, his XY position, location. Okay. Second is what? His location and my location I give. Then comes the relations. So what are the components is locations, the relations. And I said location alone will not mean anything. All the attributes about that person, or if it is a water body or if it is a building, we put about all those things. So location, relations, attributes and time. So what are the major four components of spatial data are? Locations, relations, attributes, and the time wherever needed. Based on your application you store. Because you know, moment you say time can be stored, as I said, if I take the rainfall. Today's rainfall, yesterday's rainfall, day before yesterday's rainfall, I can put comma, comma, comma. Or I'll say last year annual rainfall, this year annual rainfall. Or I can say the change in the rainfall pattern. Many ways the time can be stored. So based on the application, people try to store it. So, but basically what are the components of spatial data are? Location, relations, attributes, and time. So your GIS must be able to handle all these four types of data. And next thing is, whenever you are working on GIS, one has to keep in mind picture is, what you are trying to represent or put into a GIS. I gave an example of our campus, IIT campus. It's a big area, okay? So suppose I am working on an application of IIT alone, what I'll do? I'll have a big map. In fact, if you come to my lab, you'll see I have 22 sheets surveyed for this campus and they are given. Okay? So the scale in I am working is in a large scale. Because I need every building, I need every electrical pole, every piece of small land I need it because I am working an application for the campus alone. Suppose somebody works for the entire Mumbai. Their IIT Bombay may be a small polygon. Agreed? It may be a small unit. They don't bother where this building is there or where CSRE is there. It may be just, okay, it's an IIT Bombay campus, they may write. Same thing, somebody works for the entire Maharashtra state. Even Mumbai may be a small polygon. Their IIT ka dot may be there, may not be there. So, you know, in which same feature can be represented as a point, can be represented as a polygon, can be represented as a unit with many polygons. So, you know, a spatial object can be represented in multiple ways. So, again, a user has to decide in which scale he is working and what detail he needs it. Okay? So, same feature can be given in a multiple representation. Okay. Now, what are the objects we have to see it? When we define an object, I said point can be an object, a polygon can be an object. So what we assume when we define an object in a GIS is, you have to see, we assume there is a homogeneity within that object. So I am putting a boundary, a water body. I am trying to handle it as a single entity in a GIS. So when I put that object, I am assuming the whole list with the water. See, actually, if you map a lake, pura, it may not have water. It may have muddy land, little swamp area, and then underneath when you go, there may be water. But when we treat it as a single entity in a GIS, we assume it's a only one entity and one record will be there with a set of attributes. Within that entity, I cannot say yes, a little mud is there, little area of water is there, a little swamp area is there. We don't do it. So, you know, an entity is considered as a single entity where we assume there need not be homogeneity, but we assume homogeneity and then store it. That also one has to keep in mind. And whenever you store the attributes, attributes can be in a single table, attributes can be in multiple tables, but reference to the same object. Simple cases, what? Villages. You go to census department, you will get so much of data about that village. You may not be able to put all the attributes in a table. So what we do? Okay, education, one table. Health, another table. Demography, another table. But all these tables belong to that record, belong to the same village. There should be a link. So that when I query, show me the villages which have zero school, one hospital, and you know, 100 children going to school. It should link all those tables and give you the answer. Okay, so the data, when you organize it, spatial object is treated as a single entity, but the tables can be multiple tables, again, based on your application. So with this little concept of spatial objects, how do we define that, put the spatial objects? People who are working on GIS will be definitely knowing what way we put it, either points, or lines, or polygons. Three major categories. But you know, today if you go to GIS, we are not handling three major sequence of objects are possible. They're all, you know, multi-line, multi-polygon, multi-geometry. If you go to the latest, see, I'm not covering you the latest developments in GIS in this lecture because they have asked me to speak only overview. If you go today in GIS, what is the standard is? It doesn't sit only with point, line and polygon. Multi-polygon, multi-line, multi-points and multi-geometry, which concerns point, line and polygon. Okay? That is the way it has been defined. But the basically everything, the core is point, x comma y. With a point, naturally can we not make a line? When I go in an ordered form, I get the line. Then when I start here and close here, the same point, I get the polygon. So the basic spatial objects are points, lines and polygons over which all those extensions have come today. So when in GIS, we treat them as to define the dimensions, because you may wonder, why do we define the dimensions? The reason we define the dimensions are totally we are working on geometry. So I have to relate, I have to query between objects, I have to get a solution between objects. So the basic dimensions play an important role. Point is always treated as an object with zero dimension. In GIS, point is treated because it doesn't have a measure, no length, no breadth, isn't it? Point is treated as zero dimension, line with one dimension, area with two, in case you work on volume, three. Okay, so this is the way we define the dimensions. So that one has to keep in mind. And you know, the scale of observation or mapping will affect what might be represented in a GIS. This I told you already. The same feature can be a point, the same feature can be a polygon. So based on the resolution you are working, scale you are working, it can be a zero dimension, it can be on a two dimension. Okay, and the relations, how do we store the relations? Relations, when you see, that is an area itself called spatial relations. Books are available, theses are available, papers are available. What do you say, how do we relate the objects? I said, you know, the dimensions play an important role, because if I take a point, if I put point on a line, it is different. When I put a point on a polygon, it is different. When I take a point and put it in the space, it's different. Because that point is in a three-dimensional object. When I put it a point in a polygon, I'm putting the point in a two-dimensional object. So when you try to work on the relations for the query, naturally the dimensions play a role. And how do we relate those spatial objects? So people, there are good standards available to define the spatial relations between the objects. Okay, simple thing which is available, I just put a point can be a neighbor to a point can lie on a line, a point can be a centroid, or it can lie, a school can be within a village, it can be within a polygon, etc. So one can relate the spatial objects. There is a standard today followed in GIS, all with the latest standards. You want to know about it, there is something called 9 intersection matrix, which had been done very well by a professor in US, which has become a standard which all the latest GIS tools they follow. 9i matrix we call it, and all the spatial relations which can exist between these kinds of objects have been well defined and even standardized. Okay, so spatial relations come into picture. So we saw what all the components of spatial data, what are the possible spatial entities, and what type of relations that may exist. Now comes, how do we store them? Naturally, what comes into picture when we store into a digital tool? How to model it? How do we store? Because you know, when you see with eyes, you know everything. We immediately, we can, okay, this person is sitting in front of me or standing in front of me, everything it automatically goes here. But when the question of GIS comes, we have to put it into the database. There comes the data model. A data model is essential to represent the spatial data in a spatial database. That is what is a spatial model. A data model. See, basically a data model, what it gives you the guidelines. How do you store your data in such a way? You store the entities as well as the relations between the entities. So when you look at that data model, broadly, two data models are possible. Simple, again, I'm taking you the simplest available, the raster and vector models. Okay, maybe when somebody covered GIS or He gave an example, he would have given you something from a raster or vector. I'll try to give you a little bit about both these models. So raster is very easy, very simple. It is nothing. It is equivalent to an image data. Remote sensing has grown where you have all the remote sensing images in terms of rows and columns. It's a matrix. N rows by M columns. It's a matrix where the values of the reflectance is stored. Same concept has been put. Because whatever is done in image processing can be directly used in GIS. So raster is nothing. It is only a data in a matrix form where you take the data, put the grids, try to store the data for each grid, the value. Very, very simple, very easy to handle, which is going. So when you look at it, raster model divides the entire area into regular grid of cells in a specific sequence. In fact, you know, if you look at it, there are areas where, you know, again, people work different models. Instead of putting a square grid, people have worked how to put a hexagon. This all went on a research level where, you know, no GIS tool came. Grid became very famous because I said image processing handles a grid pattern, a pixel pattern from where the theory could be picked up and used in GIS. People did research on different kinds of tessellating the terrain. But among all of them, normal grid became very common and useful. Okay, so raster model divides the entire area into regular grid of cells. And whenever you have a raster, if you have a data for an area, you cannot leave some cell empty. If it is empty, at least you have to put a zero value. So it's a space filling. Every cell should have value. If you have only five schools, that five grids you may put to school number 1, 2, 3, 4. Remaining cells, come say come, you will put 0, 0. Okay? So it is a space filling. And very crucial is the resolution or the cell size. How finer I go to the cell size, how coarser I go to the cell size. Coarser, you lose information. Finer, your data becomes heavy. Isn't it? As I said, I can handle 0.6 meter resolution of digital globe also. We can store, handle our own IRS data, which was once upon a time, you know, 23 meter resolution. So coarser be possible, finer is also possible. It based on the detail and how much, you know, what is your grid size which you want to handle. Accordingly, the size has to be defined. Again, here also, like I told you about spatial entity, within a cell, we assume homogeneity. Only in single value can be stored in a cell. Okay, one cell gives a single value, that one has to keep in mind. So all variations within the cell is lost, and one set of cells and associated values form a layer. I have a land use map. I can say this is the grid where the values are stored, so that, you know, 10 rows by 10 columns where you have the values, you have a land use map. So what? You don't store row comma column number. You put the value in that row comma column number. Okay, 1, 1, 1, 1, 2, 2, 2, 2, 3, 4, like that you make it. Your land use map, 1 means what, 2 means what, 3 means what. That is what you try to store. Okay, so each cell you try to put a value. So raster model tells what occurs at each place. One set of cells and associated values is a layer. It can be elevation, it can be land use, it can be, you know, soil category or anything. Since those days, what we used to do, we used to take a map. Those days, you know, there was no digitizer or scanner and all. We used to have a template of our grid size, put it over the map, pick out what is there contained in that grid, and manually code it and enter through the keyboard. Today, scanners are available. Directly, you take a map, scan it. You change the DPI to what level you need. So you decide the resolution. Data is ready for you for processing. Okay, so that technology has changed, and whenever we use remote sensing, directly digital data is available, you don't need to worry at all. So raster data is readily available. Only thing is, whenever you use raster data from remote sensing, what you have to keep in mind? Their projections are different, resolutions are different, area of coverage may not be the same. You have to do pre-processing, geo-register them, then only you can bring it as a layer remote sensing data. That one has to keep in mind. Okay, so And see, resolution, I said, it's very important because we assume homogeneity within a cell. And another thing is, when you look at a GIS, see, in remote sensing, normally they give 8-bit value. Normally, you know, when you take a single band image, they give 8-bit value, 0 to 255. See, nowadays, you know, later some of the higher resolution satellites, they give 6-bit value, 7-bit value. But, you know, in GIS, what can happen is, you can have 8-bit value, which is what? A byte. Like 0 to 255, your pixel value can be there. But there may be cases where, instead of 8-bit, your values may be more. Let me take a case. I am trying to handle, in the raster model, all the villages of, let me say, one district of Maharashtra. There may be how many villages? There may be thousands of villages. Okay, so let me say there are 1,000 villages in a district, in that district. Then can I give 1111 for one village, 222 for second village, like that? If I give a raster, what do I do after 255? Number of villages I have is 1,000. So I may have to handle the case where the number of pixel values will be greater than 8-bit. So in a GIS, when you have the raster values, it can be byte, it can be integer, or it can be float value. When float value, you get it, like we say elevation. You take, okay, a contour of 640, next contour of 660. You interpolate in between. Will it give you everything round figure? When you interpolate, point something, it will write. So you may have to handle integers, float, as well as byte. So a grid value in a raster can be of these three categories. Because, you know, whenever you use a GIS, it will ask you. In a raster mode, if you go, it will ask you whether your data is byte, or it's a float, or an int. Again, based on your thematic map, you have to give this. Okay? So that is possible. And also, the limitation in raster or the one is homogeneity. Whenever a boundary passes between your cell, naturally, we compromise. Whichever area covers more, we give that value to that. We can't help it. Okay? So these are limitations. Of course, you know, I'm not showing you, I'm not going deeper into the theory on raster model. See, to